Hey, welcome to this first video in this new section of my Understanding Gradle series. In this and the following videos, I'll talk about modularization concepts of Java itself. A fundamental concept here is the class path. In the previous videos, we have seen several places where a class path is used in Gradle, like in dependency management, in the Java compile task or the test task. If you have followed the videos so far and you still wonder how this works in detail down on the Java level, we'll fill this gap in this and the following videos. If you're new to my video series, this is also a good entry point. We'll start at looking at how things in Java and then go up from there and see how they integrate into Gradle and why you might want to use Gradle on top of the tooling Java already provides. As usual, I'll use plain Java in the examples to explain the concepts. But all languages and platforms based on Java use the same concepts. So if you do Android development, you also have class passes, or if you do Kotlin development, even not targeting Java, you have this concept as well. So also, if you are developing Android, Kotlin, Scala, Groovy, this should give you interesting insights. In the video today, we'll look at the fundamental idea of a class path and what it is. Then in the next videos, we'll explore where different class passes turn up in larger projects and which issues arise from that. Then eventually, we'll also talk about the module path, which was introduced with Java 9 and which moves more modularization concepts into the Java language directly. This can be used as a replacement for the class path, and we'll discuss pros and cons in one of the future videos. So where does the term class path originate from? The term is made up of two words, class and path. Path here is used in the sense how it is used in other places in computing. Like you might know your path variable from your operating system, which points at folders where you have executables or tools that you want to have easily accessible. On this path in the Java context, we put classes, hence the term class path. Class here stands for files with the .class extensions, which contain compiled bytecode. In this sense, everything you write in Java or another Java-based language is compiled to a class, even if in source code it is an interface or an enumeration. All these classes can be put on a class path, and then you can write or execute programs that use these classes that are found on the class path. The entries on a class path are not the class files directly, but either folders containing a number of class files or jar files, which are zip files following a certain format that contain the class files. In addition, these can also contain other files like images that you can then use in your programs by discovering them on the class path. So here I have a folder hierarchy that only contains one Java source file with a class that is empty. There aren't any Gradle scripts or other files in here yet. We'll start by using the tools provided by Java, by the JDK, directly. So the first thing we want to do is compile our class, which we can do with the Java C tool, the Java compiler. We call Java C, giving it an output location for the compiled class files and pointing it at our source code, which is only the one Java class. Java C then produces the bytecode for that class. We haven't yet used any explicit class path here. But implicitly, all the types provided by the JDK, like the object type from which all classes extend, are available automatically on the class path all the time. Now, let's use some additional types in our source code. For example, let's do some logging using the SLF4j library. For that, we can download the SLF4j API jar from the internet and put it into a libs folder, for example, here in our folder hierarchy. Then in our source code, we can use classes from this jar file, like the logger factory or the logger interface. If we now call the Java C tool as we did before, the compiler complains that these classes are missing. So now we can provide the class path as an additional argument. In our case, the class path needed for compilation only needs the one additional jar we just downloaded, because it contains all the classes that are required to compile this code. If we do that, the compilation works again and the compiled class file has been updated. As our source code contains a main method, we could run this as a Java program. Java programs run on the Java virtual machine, so you don't execute your program directly, but you use the Java command and give it the main class, so the entry point of your application to run. If we run Java and only provide our class as an argument, it complains that it can't find the class, because we haven't given it to it on the class path. So also the Java command takes a class pass argument. Here, we now also need to add the folder where our compiled classes are located, because to run the application, we need the code we compiled before. So you can see that there's a difference between class pass we need to compile something and the class pass we need to run the thing, because to run the thing, we need the result of the compilation as well on the class pass. We also need to add the SLF4j API jar to the class pass, because otherwise these classes are missing at runtime and will get another error. Now we can run our application. However, it does not yet log our log message, but prints a warning instead. This is because the SLF4j API only provides an API to write log statements, but not a concrete implementation of a logger. This is because SLF4j allows you to dynamically exchange the implementation, which is also done via the class pass. So for instance, if we download the SLF4j simple implementation and put it in our libs folder as well, we can add this to the class pass of the Java command. And then the logger implementation in this jar will be discovered at runtime and used. So this is one of the features that makes Java and the Java virtual machine so powerful. You can add or exchange components without recompiling any code by changing the class path with which you start the application. So looking at this very simple example, we can already see why you might want to use a tool like Gradle. There are quite some manual steps involved if you change something. You have to download jars from the internet, you have to manually construct the class passes, which clearly have an overlap, and if you change something and want to run the application, you first have to manually call the compilation. And as you probably know, these are all things Gradle can do for you plus more. So let's see where we can find the class pass concept as we used it here in Gradle. I turn this into a Gradle project by adding an empty settings Gradle KTS and an empty build Gradle KTS. For a real project, you would now apply one of the Java plugins in the build Gradle file, or do that through one of your convention plugins. But to better demonstrate how things work under the hood, I won't apply one of these plugins today. Instead, we register the tasks to compile and run Java directly. As you may remember if you watched my video about tasks, if you don't apply any plugins, Gradle basically don't have any functionality to work with the code. But instead of applying plugins, you can also register tasks yourself. So we will register the tasks we require for compiling and running Java code now and see how the class path plays into it. So the first thing is to register a Java compile task. You can find all the details about the inner workings of this task in my video on that topic. The most essential thing, comparing to what we did before, is that you can think of this task as something that wraps the Java C command and does additional stuff for you. So similar to when we called the Java C command, this task needs an output location for the class files and it needs to know where our source code is located. Then, because of implementation details in the task, we need to explicitly define which Java version we target, which we could have also done on the command line Java C tool if we wanted that. That's already enough for a minimal configuration of the task. So if we run this task now with Gradle, it attempts to compile our Java class. We again get the error that the types we are using from SLF4j cannot be found, because we haven't defined a class path yet. Now we add that to the task configuration and let it point directly at the SLF4j API file in our libs folder. And now the compilation works, similar to how it worked when we called Java C directly. Of course, now Gradle functionality already kicks in and helps us. For example, the task is up to date if we run it again. If we would compile multiple Java files, the task would take care of incremental compilation, which means if we only change one file that's independent of the others, it would only recompile that one. So this is all functionality you get by the Gradle task on top of the plain Java C compiler. Now let's also run our application. For that, Gradle offers the Java exec task, which is essentially a wrapper around the Java command, and you can use it to execute arbitrary Java applications. So there are only two things you need to configure. The first thing is the main class, the entry point of the application, as we have done when we called the Java command directly, and of course also the class path, because we've learned we can't run a Java application without any class path because the application itself needs to be on it. Now, instead of providing the static location of our class files, we can tell Gradle to put the output of the Java compile task on the class path. With that, we don't need to repeat ourselves, and Gradle also automatically knows the dependencies between the tasks. So if we just run our application, Gradle automatically compiles the code before. In addition, we also put the SLF4J API and SLF4J simple jar files on the class path as we did before when we called the Java command. If we run this task with Gradle now, we can see that the compilation will be executed before, might be up to date, and the application is executed similar to how it's done when we call the Java command directly. So we already saw some of the advantages Gradle gives us by using it instead of the plain Java tools. But we also see how these things relate to each other and are very similar. Basically, we give the same arguments to the Gradle task that we gave directly to the Java C and the Java executable before. Now let's explore how Gradle can help us to ease the construction of the class passes. So we already have two class passes. We have the compile class path in the compile task. Let's put this into a variable called compile class path. And we have a runtime class path for the Java exec task. Let's put this into a variable called runtime class path. Now these two class passes have similarities, like both using SLF4J API. Let's extract these similarities into a separate variable. Let's call this implementation, as these are things you need to write and compile your code. For completeness, let's put everything else from the runtime class path into a variable called runtime only. Now, the compile class path and the runtime class path are different combinations of these two lists of files. If you know Gradle, you might have seen these names are used here before. So the thing we are still missing compared to a real Gradle project is the retrieval of the jars from a repository. So far, we downloaded them manually, and if we want to update them, like use a new version and so on, we would have to re-download them and possibly also put them into our version control system, which we would like to avoid. For this, Gradle has the whole dependency management part. Now, how would that look like? First thing is, we need to tell Gradle where to look for these jars, which are done through Maven repositories. For open source software like SLF4J, you would use Maven Central. Then, instead of defining dependencies in terms of jar file names, we can define them in terms of coordinates, which the repository knows about. So let's change the entries here from the file names to the so-called coordinates, consisting of group name and version. And now we can use Gradle and resolve them to the actual files through the repository, and also to download the files and cache them to make this performant on the long run. And this connection is done through the configuration concept in Gradle, about which I talked in more detail in other videos like the one on declaring dependencies or about aggregating artifacts. So instead of just having lists of names here, we can create configurations. So we create an implementation configuration, a runtime-only configuration, and we create a compile class path configuration and a runtime class path configuration, and combine the implementation and runtime-only configurations in them by using the extends from keyword. Now the compile class path and runtime class path configurations are used in our tasks instead of the list of plain files. And now we can use the implementation and runtime only configurations to declare dependencies in terms of coordinates. Now that we have done this, when we run the task again, Gradle will do the so-called dependency resolution. That is, it will recognize that parts of our class path are now defined through configurations, and it will look at the declared dependencies and look in the repositories to find the jar files for these dependencies. And it will download them, and then in the end will put them on the class path, so that the class path the Java compiler or the Java tool sees looks similar to what we had before, just that the jar files are now not located in our lib folder, but somewhere in Gradle's dependency cache. So what we have done here now is essentially what Gradle's Java plugins do. So if we would, for example, apply the application plugin, we wouldn't need to create these configurations because the plugin is doing that for us. And also, configuring the task with these class passes as input is something the plugin does. So only declaring the dependencies using these already available configurations is what is left to do in our own build file. For completeness, let's also look at testing. In a real project, you would most likely also have tests. For example, written using JUnit. These tests are then also Java classes that use JUnit as an additional dependency on the class path. To execute tests, Gradle has a test task, which is in a way similar to the Java exec task because it essentially also executes the Java application that runs the tests. Gradle does some more here than just calling the Java command with your tests to allow for more effective testing like parallelization of tests. All the details can be found in my video about the test task. So configuring a test task is somehow similar to configuring a Java exec task, but instead of defining a main class, because the main class here is provided by JUnit, if you will, we define a folder where the tests are located. Let's just put a test right next to our main source class. Then the test class files will also be produced by our compile Java task, and we can set it so the output of the task as a place for the test task to look for the test classes. To write the tests using JUnit, so for example JUnit's test annotation, we also need JUnit on the class path. For this example, let's add it as implementation dependency so it ends up in the compile and the runtime class path. Because this is also a Java execution, we usually need the runtime class path here. The difference to the Java exec task is that the test task has outputs, which are the test reports. The minimal setup of this is to define a location for the binary version of the report data and deactivating all other reports. With this setup, we can run our test task and it will execute our one test method with JUnit. For more information about how to configure and set up testing on larger scale, you can check out my different videos about testing with Gradle. One thing that would definitely be different in a real project is that the tests are not mixed with our production code. So we would put them in a different folder and we would compile them separately. And we probably also don't want to have JUnit on the class path for production code. So we would not only need a separate compile task to compile the test code, we would also need a separate compile class path and a separate runtime class path, which can be, of course, combinations of the class paths or configurations we have defined before. That's how the Java plugins in Gradle do it. And then we'll have a test runtime class path and a test compile class path, and we'll have test implementation as additional configuration for dependencies that are only required for the tests. This all shows that even in a simple project, there is not only one class path, but at least two, one for compilation and one for execution. And if you add tests, you have additional class paths. And then, if you grow your project and have separate components or separate subprojects, all of these will have their own class paths. The implications, advantages, and disadvantages of this will be the topic we look at in the next video. Please subscribe to this channel so you won't miss it. See you then.